Thanks for being here. And thank you very much, Ambassador. Thank you very much, Professor. Let me begin with a brief introduction with Center for Rural Studies, Studies of Rural Societies. The mission of CSPSC is to discover the ideas that enrich humanity for an ethical, sustainable, equitable, and just future. CSPSC believes in diversity and plurality of ideas and disciplines. CSPSC draws its inspiration from Maulana Abul Kalam Azad, Maulana Muhammad Ali Johar, Mahatma Gandhi, Subhash Chandra Bose, and all international personalities who have contributed to making a plural and multicultural world. The center aims at studying all issues and problems of the country in a complete, objective, scientific, and disciplined way, guided by the universal values of pluralism. CSPSC encourages young scholars and researchers to advance their research skills and be a part of the internationally recognized research and development community by producing recognizable works. So today we are here with a wonderful topic, with a wonderful subject to discuss, which is the Indo-US strategy and challenges ahead, by a very esteemed Professor Muqtadir Khan, who is a professor in the Department of Political Science and International Relations at the University of Delaware. He researches and teaches Islam, governance, and international relations. He earned his PhD in international relations, political philosophy, and Islamic political thought from Georgetown University in May 2000. From 2017 to 2019, he was the academic director of the State Department's National Security Institute. And from 2019 onwards, he is the academic director of the State Department's American Foreign Policy Institute. He founded the Islamic Studies program at the University of Delaware and was its first director from 2007 to 2010. He is the author of Islam and Good Governance, a political philosophy of Islam. Islam and Good Governance has been recognized as an all-time best books on political philosophy. He also authored American Muslims, Bridging Faith and Freedom, Jihad for Jerusalem, Identity and Strategy in International Relations, and he has edited Islamic Democratic Discourse and Debating Moderate Islam, The Geopolitics of Islam and the West. I happen to just hear from him that he has come with a wonderful e-book, which perhaps Professor Rasal would introduce us in his talk. And may I also welcome our esteemed Ambassador Ashok Sajjanha as a chair to this session. Ambassador Ashok Sajjanha has worked for the Indian Foreign Services for over three decades. He was the ambassador of India to Kazakhstan, Sweden, and Latvia, and has worked in diplomatic positions in Washington, D.C., Brussels, Moscow, Geneva, Tehran, Dhaka, and Bangkok. He negotiated for India in the Uruguay round of the multilateral trade negotiations for India, EU, India, ASEAN, and India, Thailand Free Trade Agreement. He has worked as the head of the National Foundation for Communal Harmony. He is currently the president of Institute of Global Studies in New Delhi. Ambassador Sajjanha writes and speaks on issues relating to international relations and Indian foreign policy. For me, he is just like a teacher to me, as I have been to his multiple talks while I was student in JNU, and hence I regard him as my teacher as well, and a very esteemed ambassador. Thank you very much, sir, for being here. And I would like to request you to take the command now. And
thank you very much, Dr. Sumaya Ahmed. Thank you for this very generous and gracious words of introduction. Thank you also to CSPS for this invitation to come here, and it's a great pleasure to have Professor Muqtadir Khan here to speak to us on this very important subject of India-US ties. As we were talking, I consider them to be absolutely the most consequential partnership for India at the current moment. So it is really good, and I'm so happy to welcome each and every one of you. I thought we could possibly do is I'll speak for about 5-7 minutes or so, give a brief introduction of where I see how things, what's the lay of the land, so to say, between the two countries, and then give the floor to Professor Muftadir Khan. He will speak for about 10 minutes or so, depending upon the time available with you, because you are the one who is, you know, short of time. So 30 minutes, and then after that we can have question answers from the floor. So if that is the thing, you know, I will not go into the past history of the relations between India and the United States. 75 years, you know, first 50 years from India's independence in 1947 till about 2000, that is one phase, because there were many ups and downs. I think India's relations with the United States during that period, Cold War period and the period of unipolarity from 1990 till about 2000, that was much of the period saw a lot of stresses and tensions in the relationship. Whether if we start right from the 1950s, when John Foster Dulles called the Northern Line Movement as you know, as an evil force or as something that the United States was totally opposed to. Then, of course, another nadir came in 1971 when we had the USS Enterprise 7th Fleet coming into the Bay of Bengal. And, of course, 1998 when we had, after our nuclear test, we had the most stringent sanctions. Of course, during this period, there were a few episodes when the relations were not so bad, whether it was during the Kennedy years or in the 1980s when Rajiv Gandhi became the Prime Minister and he traveled to the United States. But these were short-lived and few and far in between. Now, what I'm going to speak for the next 4 or 5 minutes that I have with me is about the last 23, 24 years. That is when Bill Clinton came here in March 2000. That has really seen the regular upward trajectory of the bilateral ties. And if I could also mention, he also put paid to the hyphenation between India and Pakistan at that time. Because when he came here in March 2000, he was in India for 5 days. He went to 4 or 5 cities and addressed the joint session of the Indian Parliament. And when he went to Pakistan, he only addressed the people via a telelink from the airport. He didn't even step onto the soil of Pakistan. So that was the total dehyphenation, and it is not only the United States but all the other major powers after that, whether it was Japan, Germany, UK, etc. So that also started. The point I would like to make is that from 2000 till 2024 now, the relationship has been going up, and I don't think I would be far off the mark if I were to say that relations between India and the United States today are the best that they have ever been. And, you know, what is evident from this is that there is a bipartisan support as far as India-US partnership is concerned. You look at the United States, there have been in 2000 when Clinton came, that was a Democratic dispensation. After that, for 8 years, there was a Republican dispensation, 2001 to 2009. Then for 8 years, again, Democratic, 4 years, Republican, and now last 4 years, 3.5 years also. But notwithstanding the change of party in the White House, or even for that matter in the Congress, even as far as the business and people-to-people level, there is a huge support for closer and stronger relations between India and the United States. Similar is the case in India. Let me not go through the years, because we had Mr. Vajpayee, then we had Dr. Manmohan Singh, and now we've had Mr. Modi for the last nine and a half years. But the other point I would like to make is that the relationship has really, the trajectory has become much steeper in the upward direction over the last 9-10 years. Mr. Modi has interacted with three presidents over this period, and it was thought that, you know, he was, particularly in the case of Mr. Trump, it was thought that he is investing himself too closely, you know, when the Howdy Modi event was held in Texas, and when the Namaste Trump was held, event held here in Ahmedabad. They thought he was too closely identified with Trump, and if there was a change in government, then it would be difficult. That has not happened. Mr. Biden has come. He has taken the relationship forward. If you looked at the number of times that they have met and the sort of camaraderie and the bonhomie and the cordiality that you can see between the two leaders, I think that has been quite significant. So the point that I would like to make is that today there is not only a convergence of values, both the countries are democracies, but there is also a convergence of interests. The last two points on this aspect let me make. One is, it is said that it is basically China which draws India and the United States together. China is definitely a factor, it is an important factor, but I don't think it is the only factor or it is the most compelling factor. It is an important reason, but there are so many other reasons. And there is a convergence of interest also on both sides to come together, whether it is the large and growing market of India, the huge 4 million plus diaspora, Indian diaspora in the United States, which is the most well-educated, the most prosperous, the most well-to-do, and has become very influential also. So I think there are other factors also in addition to China. The second aspect that I would like to refer to is the fact that in a relationship which is so broad and which is so wide and which is so extensive and so deep, there are bound to be areas and issues where there are differences. And there have been differences even over the last few years. And I think it depends really on the wisdom and on the maturity of the leadership of the two sides as to how to manage those differences. I think going forward, differences are not going to disappear. They will be there. But how do we manage it and ensure that the bulk of the relationship, which is in technology, which is in market, which is in investments, which is in defense, which is in exercises, which is in security, which is in Indo-Pacific, which is a subject that we are going to be talking about, that I think is what is the basic the basic elements of the bilateral ties. So let me finish here, and I think I've taken just 6 minutes, as I wanted to do. And now the floor is on to Dr. Muqtada Khan, and I think all of us are really delighted and happy that he's here. He'll share his thoughts enough that we have a good discussion.
So thank you, Ambassador. I mean, after the overview that you have given, maybe we should just go to question and answer. But I'm happy to be here. I'm quite delighted to come and talk to you. I want to recognize some people who are here. My friend Hassan Abid, who is in the civil services. And also I want to recognize Anupam, who is a subscriber of Conversations, and he expressed interest and delighted that he's able to attend today. What I'm going to do today is I'm going to talk from the point of view of the United States and how, from a strategic perspective, we see India fitting into U.S. foreign policy. And and then I will make some provocations about India-U.S. relations. Uzair has already heard some of it at JNU. We'll see what kind of reaction we now get to similar provocations. And then we will go forward. And the ambassador was saying that there might be some interest in asking questions about America's domestic politics, and I'll be happy to answer those questions. Our broadly three inputs into American foreign policy. Number one are the domestic factors. For example, there is no way to explain the United States ironclad, as Biden likes to call, ironclad support to Israel. The United States support to Israel violates all basic values that the United States has been trying to promote overseas: human rights, democracy, rule of law, and so on and so forth. So how do you explain that? And it also undermines a lot of U.S. interests because it generates lots of anti-Americanism, and many countries other than Israel are not very happy with the U.S. And now the way the Houthis are responding, triggered by Iran, and you can see that it is undermining not just the rule-based order, but it's also undermining the architecture of the Middle East as well as the broader structure of the region's security and geopolitical arrangement. So why is America paying such a huge cost, even looking hypocritical? So for example, when you ask, is Russia committing a genocide in Ukraine? The answer is yes. Is Israel committing a genocide in Gaza? The answer is, oh, well, we don't know. We're not experts. The same guys who are eager to immediately pronounce judgment on Russia's genocidal intents and actions, then suddenly say we are not qualified to judge whether this is genocide or this is a legal matter. And there are lots of memes out there with John Kirby simultaneously, you know, his opinions on Ukraine and this. So they are risking all of this. And the only way you can explain that is through domestic factors, domestic politics. And then, of course, there are external factors. The most pronounced one is the rise of China and the threat of China, the challenge that China presents to American primacy in the. So the new policies that America is pursuing, the most important one is the Indo-Pacific strategy, is essentially triggered not by domestic factors or values, but by the rise of China. So you can see that American foreign policy is constantly responding to challenges that are external and concerns and interests that are domestic. But there is a third element also that kind of overarchingly shapes American foreign policy, and that is grand strategy, a vision of how America wishes to engage with the world. If you ask me what is grand about grand strategy, then I would tell you that it is about essentially America's vision of how the world is shaped. And it's not just about marshalling all sources of national power to project American power abroad and advance American interests, but also to create a system which is friendly to. So if you look at the way the rule-based order is has developed since World War II, if you are America's friend, then the system lifts you. And if you're not friendly with America, the system suppresses you. So that systemic effect is a consequence of America's grand strategy, America's multilateral. America is an empire that governs through multilateral institutions. And that's why the power of the US dollar, the United States influence in IMF, in Security Council, and America's influence in financial institutions like IMF and World Bank, and lots of other multilateral institutions. So go a step back. All right, so these are the three sources, and I'm going to talk a little bit about grand strategy. So if you go to the next slide, so I'm going to give you a very quick and short example to explain. So for example, if you are fighting a war, like Houthis are now shooting rockets and missiles and one-way drones at ships, how do you deal with Houthis? So you need to have guided missiles, Patriot type of missiles that can deal with all those rockets coming. You can have satellites which can give you early warning systems that as soon as the missile takes off from Yemen or some boat in the ocean. Well, all of such responses are tactical responses as the missile is coming up and so on. What is the strategic way to respond? It's something bigger than just shooting down rockets, and you must have heard that yesterday the United States has reached out to China and actually appealed to China to put pressure on Iran, to put pressure on Houthis. Now that is a strategic response to what Houthis are doing. Just blocking their rockets or going and bombing their places where they are launching is a tactical response. So the grand strategy is a bigger response than that. It's about statecraft. It's about a vision. Not all countries, I think, can make grand strategies. They can have long-term visions, but grand strategy is about not just marshalling the sources of your power, but also having a structural impact on the global system. And very few countries can do that. And in the last 2-3 years, you're hearing India talk a lot about reforming the multilateral system. In fact, when India had its Security Council leadership, it ended in 2022, it ended with a conference on reform. These days, I think the Indian Ministry of External Affairs is in love with acronyms. So they keep coming up with long acronyms, our reorientation and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, so basically they want a Security Council membership with veto power to India. And they've been trying to do that. The general understanding in the field outside India, it's never going to happen. It's very simple. China will veto it. And because the West is so assured of the fact that China will veto it, they can give lip service by saying, yeah, we need to respond. It's not moving and it's not going to move. Unless there's an alteration in the balance of power in the real world. Even the alteration in the balance of power does not have an impact unless the power is exerted. So, for example, by 1880s, the United States had become more economically more powerful than Britain. But the U.S. chose not to try and dominate world politics, let Pax Britannica continue until 1945, because it kind of suited their interests. So, alteration in balance of power does not necessarily mean there will be shifts in the structure of global governance unless the newly emerging power acts to do that. So, for example, some of the moves that China is making is to try to design to restructure global politics, because it feels that the current, India also feels that the current structure of global governance does not reflect the new altered balance of power in the world, and so basically does not reflect new realities. There are new powers, according to India, in world politics with India, but India is not part of global governance. Countries like France have nuclear power and veto power and permanent membership in Security Council. Italy is part of G7, India is not. So the global governance is not reflected. So what is US grand strategy? There is one aspect of U.S. grand strategy which does not change at all. It's a status quo power. As long as it's number one, it doesn't want anything to change. It will continue to remain number one. So, in a simple way, the goal of the United States is to sustain, maintain, prolong its primacy, to remain number one for as long as it likes, and to sustain the system of governance which facilitates that. So the United States is right now weaponizing many of these international institutions, like SWIFT against Russia, for example. It has already used its veto, I think, twice to protect Israel. So this system helps it in order to pursue its interest and also protect the interests of its allies. Generally, can we go to the next slide?
Sure.
So, there are four generic grand strategies that one can talk about. One is isolationism, which means you become so powerful or maintain sufficient strength that if anyone threatens you, you have the capacity to punish them, but you do not engage with the world. You just continue doing that. And the United States for a long time more or less remained isolationist, particularly with regards to Europe and European geopolitics. And that allowed it to internally develop and advance its economy, etc., especially from 1850s onwards till beginning of World War I, the U.S. I mean, some people say that if the U.S. had not remained isolationist, perhaps we may not have had those wars. But the fact that the U.S. was isolationist. So isolationism was a policy that the U.S. could protect, because the U.S. is like a foot. It has two oceans around it, which are like moats, which protect it. Even today, I don't think there's any country which has the capability to land troops in the United States. And there's a threat of invasion of the United States. It's kind of funny thinking of China. How is China going to get this? Get the ships across the Pacific Ocean and bring millions of people? If China had the capacity to invade the U.S., it would have already invaded Taiwan by now. Because some of the simulations on Chinese invasion of Taiwan are very, very bloody. China may be able to defeat Taiwan
conquered Taiwan, but holding on is not that easy. So invasions are not a small thing to do. Just the fact that the US keeps doing it, whether it's Afghanistan or Iraq or elsewhere, doesn't mean any other country can do it. So the United States felt pretty safe to remain isolated, not engaging in other parts, left it to the British to maintain global order or whatever. The other alternative strategy that the United States has contemplated, and it's sometimes pursued, is the opposite of isolationism, which is global domination. You dominate everything. And any change anywhere, Maldives spat with India, it concerns the U.S. I'm sure there have been a couple of discussions inside the State Department as well as the DOD as to the implications of what's going on between India. Maldives, they have not issued any official statement, does not mean, but you can see already people in Indian think tanks thinking and writing about this issue, because there's no part of the globe that we are not concerned with. And so there is, even though we may not have the capacity for global domination, we are interested in all issues of exerting power. I am quite critical of India's claim that it is a world power and this is a multipolar system, etc. Militarily, it is not. The Israel-Hamas factor, I don't see India playing any role there. India claims to be the voice of the global south. As far as Gaza is concerned, there is nothing more south of global south. And you can see that it's South Africa, which is speaking on behalf of the global south in International Court of Justice and other places. There was a time when India would speak for apartheid South Africa, but now the Prime Minister has not once uttered his favorite dialogue. This is not an era of war since Israel attacked Gaza. Not once has that statement been repeated. So, where is the voice of global south? Where is China? If China is instigating all the things that Iran is doing with Houthis, etc., then you can say that, okay, China is trying to indirectly influence. But if the Soviet Union was there, this would not have happened. The Soviet Union would have been directly engaged. And it's quite possible Israel's response towards Gaza would have been more balanced or more restrained. And it is the absence of a bipolar balancer in the system that you find U.S. proxies acting in such blatant fashion, unlike that. So the fact is that it's still in many ways a unipolar moment. The United States still has 25% of the global economic share. There is, other than China, which comes to about 17-18%, the third biggest economy has only 5% of the global economic share, which is Japan. Okay, so there are only three countries with more than 5%. 5% Japan, 17-18% China, and 25% the US. So either economically speaking, militarily speaking, this is to me not a multipolar moment. The word multipolar to me is a code word for a world not dominated by the US. So it's more like wishful thinking than in reality. The rest of the world could take charge of the crisis that we have. See, the US, instead of playing the role of a traditional superpower maintaining global order, the US has kind of abandoned that role in these two wars. Russia versus Ukraine and Israel versus Hamas. The US is playing partisan role in both the wars. As a result of that, there are no other powers stepping up. So if this was a multipolar world, where are the other powers on the two most critical things in the world? And so that is one point. So the third strategy is called selective engagement. It was promoted primarily by Bill Clinton, basically saying, okay, we don't care about Africa, we don't care about certain issues, but we care about some issues and we will engage on those issues because they are either connected critically to the global order. So tomorrow, if Kenya attacks Botswana, is it going to impact the global order? Perhaps not. So maybe the US might stay out of it and tell France, go do something. But yes, if Russia attacks Ukraine, it can have a huge impact on the structure of world politics, and so the US will selectively engage that issue. The fourth strategy is what I think realists are recommending, which is obvious if you listen to John Mearsheimer, etc. But what I think the US is following is that of offshore balancing. Can I have the next slide, please? So I want you to imagine the world as these four. Just forget about the rest of the world. Let's say, so I'm giving you a sample example to so that you can understand what I mean by offshore balancing. So let us assume that there is the Americas, North and South, there is Europe, Middle East and Asia. And what you see on this side is what I'm calling their national comprehensive power in units. So let's say the US has 100 units of power, China has 60, Russia has 30, India 20, Iran 10, Brazil 10, Australia 10, Japan 20. More or less, this is your distribution of national power, which alone tells you right away that it's not a multipolar world. So you can add Italy to it, it would be around 5 or whatever. So this is the four areas that America is interested in. So now, if you go to the next slide, and if you see, Brazil is the biggest power in America with 10 power. So if the US were to deploy 20 units of power in the Americas, it can dominate. It would be the most powerful player in the Americas, twice as powerful as the next most powerful. This is complete domination of the region. If you look at the Middle East, Iran is the most powerful country there with 10 units, and the US, if it deploys 20 in the Middle East, it will again be the most powerful resident power in the region. A complete domination because you're twice as powerful as the next most powerful. If you go to Europe, you see that Russia has 30. If America deploys 40, it may not be dominating Europe, but it is clearly a hegemonic power. It has significant influence over there. But now the US has exhausted 80 units. What it has left is only 20. And China, which is not messing around anywhere else, has 60 in the region. So the US is now facing a hegemonic China. In simulation after simulation in the US, in various think tanks, US is losing every war to China. Because of this, because they cannot pull all these forces from all those areas. We cannot abandon all the regions and fight China in this area. China is not in those areas, so it is much more powerful in this region. So what does the US do to prevent China dominating the region? If you go to the next slide, here you can see. Now, if you bring in Japan, this is the plot. US 20, Japan 20, Australia 10, India 20, boom, that is 70. And now you have balanced China with an advantage in your favor. So this is the quad. The US needs India to balance China in the region. This is where India figures into the US national interest. There is a triadic relationship. If the US and China can do something which has never happened in history, which is manage the transition over the next 100 years from US to China without a war, then I think India-US relations will become more complicated. But as long, so it's like this, if India, US-China get close, the speed with which India and US are getting close will slow down. But if US and China go far apart, then the US will continue to ignore some irritations in India and come try and come closer to India. If China continues to threaten India, then India will ignore some of the irritations that it has with the US and come close. So you can see the triadic relationship that is going to determine the geopolitics of the region as we see it. Now, with that preliminary presentation as to how US grand strategy works, the US likes to fight with allies. It's called force multiplier effect. So, for example, during the Cold War, the United States in the 1950s had 50% of the global GDP. The Soviet Union at its peak had only 12.5% of the global GDP. The Soviets never hit 20% or 15%. There was no comparison at all. At all, it was like, I don't know why we thought that the Soviet Union was a... That's why when people say Soviet Union is not, China is not Soviet Union, they're talking about China's economic strength. The gap between US, US is around 27 trillion, China is 21 trillion. The gap between US and China economically is much, much smaller than the gap between US and the Soviet Union. The US was double or close to triple the size. And then add to that all of Western Europe, add to that Canada, Australia, and they suddenly have a 15% Soviet Union and like 50, 60, 70% the West in terms of just the global GDP, the capacity to develop, and then perhaps even technological advantage in many other areas. So the United States is able to increase its influence, increase its power through allies. Americans have understood this very early on, and so a very powerful alliance like NATO exists. It's been extended into Asia with all kinds of special relationships with South Korea, with Australia, with Japan, and a similar offer was made to India, which India did not accept. So basically, you know, NATO plus Israel also has enjoyed some of those. Which means you are allowed to do train with NATO, get some of the technology they need. So the alliance plus is like, you cannot, who is China's threat other than North Korea and Iran to some extent? Nothing. China doesn't have many friends. The US has huge. France, Great Britain, Germany, Japan, South Korea, Canada, industrial nations, etc. So there is a huge advantage that the U.S. continues to have at the moment with regards to China. So now I'm going to ask you, so I make some provocative statements, as I said, and then I'll open up for questions and answers. And so you should be careful. I want one at a time. Oh, so all of them are popped up. Okay, so these are the things I want to ponder. The first point I want to make, and this is more for Americans to ponder, that India is not Australia. India is not as culturally willing to accept America's cultural domination, and now India has its own cultural project which is eventually going to clash with the US. This talk of democracy is, I don't know how, in the US we are quite worried about undemocratic things happening in India with the rise of Hindu nationalism. It is the need to balance China which overrides the U, for example, the US International Religious Freedom Commission has repeatedly recommended that India be designated as a country of particular concern. There are lots of human rights organizations who are profoundly concerned about things in India. You can see the coverage of January 22 in American newspapers. Just see the headlines. They are so different from headlines here. And so that issue, like I said, if India, if US-China become a bit normalized, then those issues will suddenly become far more critical and difficult to ignore. There has been some distance in the US-India relations. For example, Biden's declining to come for January 26 celebrations. 27 September, which is today, was supposed to be the Quad.
27 January.
Yeah, today. Yeah. It was supposed to be the Quad Summit, which has now been postponed. There is no date yet announced about it. And there are some people in Washington who feel that this might be the consequence of the Xi Jinping-Biden summit in San Francisco in November. And if China helps the U.S. in controlling the Houthis, then that would be a really big issue. It's not happened yet. Apparently, the Americans have been talking to the Chinese for more than a month now, since the Houthis started shooting. The U.S. also tried to reach out to Iran. Apparently, the U.S. U.S. had detected intelligence that ISIS was going to attack Iran, and the U.S. had alerted Iran about this way before the attack, at least a day before. So there are some changes taking place there. I don't know. So my question is, India is not Australia. Australia, as long as it remains the way it is demographically, culturally, will be happy to, you know, bandwagon with the U.S., like Great Britain, like this English-speaking country, the Five Eyes, Australia is one of them. So there is a cultural differences which may or may not have an impact in long-term relationships. The second question is, I think India is between the rock and a hard place, between China and the U.S. It is trying to balance itself with discussions of multi-alignment, etc., and says that we will try to benefit with each other. There are contradictory statements. One is that we want to stand on values, And then when they abandon values, it's about our national interests. So our multi-alignment is shaped by what is in India's interests. Then what about global values, promoting global peace and normative issues which may or may not be directly in India's interests, etc. Like trying to bring about ceasefire in the Middle East, other than changing its vote in the Security Council, what has been done. I don't see anything happening there. So the second thing is India is stuck between these two superpowers, and their relationship in many ways is going to compromise India's autonomy already in terms of reducing its trade with China, trying to reduce the trade balance with China, moving away, even though there is so much manufacturing dependency on China. So that is being dictated by the relationship between the two superpowers. So that's an issue will continue, I think, as long as China continues to rise, and we'll see how that is balanced. As long as there is no war, I think the Quad and India-US relations will be extremely beneficial to India, which is that India will boost its capacity by buying engines, technology, buying drones, there's joint investments in defense startups, etc. So there is, as long as there is no war, big time war between India or China, China or Taiwan or US and China, this is going to be a hugely beneficial thing. I like to say jokingly that the US is like Batman, it always needs a sidekick. Like Robin. So when the US went into Cold War, Europe was a sidekick. But the problem with being an American sidekick is that you are also the battlefield. So if there was a war between the US and USSR, the war would be fought in Europe. And so would India want to be the sidekick of the United States? I mean, Indians these days in their mood will tell you, oh, we have reached $3.8 trillion. We are bigger and more powerful than India. And you lose your job if you challenge that. So then it's fine. Maybe you think America is your sidekick. But whatever that relationship is, if there is a war with China, the land war may be fought in India. So that is the danger of this partnership, because the U.S. is determined to not let China steal or take away its global primacy, which it wants to sustain. That is the ultimate goal, to remain on top. No country is going to willingly give it up. You will have to take it from them. So that is an important part of this second point. The third point that I'm trying to make, that as long as there is no war, the Quad is good for you. Hundreds of thousands of students going to America, technology transfer. Janet Yellen came in, invested $500 million, at least talked about in green energy and technology in India. And so the US also benefits with the brain drain from India, thousands and thousands of doctors and engineers. The fourth question that I have to you is, will India fight for Taiwan to defend US hegemony in Asia and globally? It is my contention that if India gets into a military alliance with the US or becomes as committed to Quad as Japan is, then it will prolong US and Western hegemony into the next century. But if India comes to some kind of accommodation with China soon, and maintains what it likes to say, that we are going to maintain our strategic autonomy and follow multi-alignment, if they can actually execute these two policies, then this will be the Asian century. So, for example, if you move away from the model where the US has 2020 has advantage over, I'm quite surprised that China didn't go into Taiwan in the February when Russia went into Ukraine. It would have been very difficult for the U.S. to handle both these things at the same time. But there are lots of people feel that Xi Jinping might pull the trigger in 2025. There are lots of pressure. One is the clock. Hello, Bharati, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Bharati Chiba is a professor in Delhi University and she was a scholar in the U.S. very recently. So the question is, will the U.S. fight for Arunachal Pradesh if China and India get into it? The US was quite helpful. During the Galwan episode also, apparently lots of winter clothing came from the US. There was lots of intelligence sharing. And there was this episode in Arunachal Pradesh where the US provided real-time intelligence way in ahead, so the Indians were far prepared. So the Indian military establishment clearly has seen the advantages of being partner with the US, both materially. Now there are all kinds of military exercises, Air Force exercises, joint troops exercise on the ground in the mountains. The US has no experience of fighting at that height from India, Pakistan, and China, perhaps. China hasn't fought a war at that level since 62. So the US is learning. So I don't know, but this is a strategic question that India must have. Some people told me at the Vivekananda Institute that India has clarity on it, and the clarity is that we don't expect China, the US to fight to put boots on the ground in Arunachal Pradesh or in Ladakh. And we also have clarity on this issue that we are not going to put boots on the ground in Taiwan if there was a war. But other than that, all other kinds of cooperation is on the table, intelligence sharing, even providing the way the US is supporting Ukraine, for example. That kind of support from US is expected and may even be reciprocated in the case of Taiwan. Other than putting soldiers on the ground, all other kinds of material sharing, etc., is expected. I don't know. The US, there is no discussion like this at the moment. They are looking for a military alliance, like NATO kind of alliance. There was an idea of Asian NATO also floated, which was shot down because China was screaming at the top of its voice. So that is the questions, which is not just for Indians, but also for the US to answer the question. We say that this is the most consequential relationship of this century. That's why for the US, it will sustain our hegemony into the next century. Otherwise, we will have to accommodate China more without the help of India. Europe is becoming less and less relevant, both economically and strategically, especially in the Indo-Pacific region. And then my final question is, what is going on with this Pano Gate? It's just a one-day conference. So why was Quad postponed? Well, summit, why wasn't the date announced when it was postponed? Because if you notice, all three heads of states declined to come before it was cancelled. So we had Abe saying, I have this parliamentary meeting and I cannot come. And the Australian Prime Minister saying that their own national day is also, I think, 26th of January. How come they didn't know that before they decided that 27th would be the God? They discovered that after Biden said he's coming. I find that it's quite possible, you know, with bureaucrats, that they actually forgot that 26th January is an Australian. Everybody in India who follows cricket or everywhere should know the Boxing Day test match starts one day after the Australia Day. So, but nevertheless, there is lots of chatter in Washington about what's going on with Quad. And there's an asymmetry to Quad. India sees Quad as something else in its discussion, sees it as a strategic dialogue and partnership in various, whereas all the other three countries see that as essentially an alliance to contain China. There were some people who at JNU who were arguing with me that this has nothing to do with China at Quad, if you remember. There one professor, two professors said this is Quad has nothing to do with China. And sometimes I feel that we are living on different planets. But but the point is that it was the episode in Bhutan which rejuvenated India's interest in the Quad, and prior to that, it wasn't. So these are some of the provocations that I want to make. But there is another factor that you must not forget, that there is a very powerful now Indian-American lobby in the United States. So it's not just external factors and grand strategies which are impacting America's relations with India, but it is also domestic factors. which are shaping. When I and Fariz Zakaria chat, Fariz's father and my uncle used to compete for the Member of Parliament seat from Aurangabad. So when these two Aurangabadis chat, these are Americans talking about America's national interest and security. So it's a very different concept, right? So that is important. So you could have an election in which you have Nikki Haley competing with Kamala Harris. So regardless of who wins, perhaps the first female president of the United States would be an Indian American. So I'm going to stop with that and be happy to take questions, comments.
Good. Thank you very much, Dr. Khan, for your very expansive presentation, both on the U.S. processes of U.S. formulation of U.S. foreign policy, grand strategy, and also where does India fit into that. So, floor is open.